You'll have a nanny.
What are you guys talking
about? Hey, Dad.
What? Ow.
Sorry. Can we set up a time for the Spence interview?
Spence interview? What interview?
Spence interview.
Don't you want to do it when?
Now.
No, you can't do the interview. You want to set up a time for it now?
I thought we were going to do it now.
Oh, no. Well, right now I have this thing I'm doing. It's a film.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, you could hear what's going on.
Yeah, pretty much.
I got the actors going in there, and I got to shoot it, and I've got to, you know. So maybe what we can do is go bother Emma. She's the producer. She doesn't do anything.
Okay.
Go bother her.
Hey, Emma.
Hey, girls.
Can we set up a time for the Spence interview?
Yes. Can you talk to David Webb, though? Because I'm a little busy right now.
Copy that. Thanks.
Hey, David.
Oh, man, what do you want?
Do you know where we can do the interview with his dad?
Oh, listen, I'm too busy. You gotta, like, get up. What the hell? Ask Cisco.
And then
Hi.
He wants to move.
Can you help us with the interview with his friend?
We're just going with Chief Vivian can help you.
Vivian? Can you help us with the Spence interview? Like, we need to know when to schedule it. Is that a yes?
How are we gonna do this interview?
Well, we have to force him somehow.
But we can tie Nobody. Him up, and we can get rope from the props department.
Wait, yeah, that's such a good idea. Oh my god.
What is this? What are you doing?
You've left us absolutely no choice.
You have to do the interview.
And now you have to do the interview.
What interview?
Hi, I'm Francesca Scorsese.
And I'm Ines Barquet.
We're here in Taipei for the shooting of Martin Scorsese's new film, Silence, where we spent our spring break working on the set as production assistants.
Many of you sent questions that you want him to answer. Thank you for your thoughtful questions and for helping us with our project.
Okay, first question. I'm getting older. Let's go.
Okay.
As I wait.
Oh my goodness.
What is Silence about and how did this project originate?
Oh, Silence is based on a great Japanese novel. It was written in the 1960s. And it's about the 17th century in southern Japan, where there was a great conflict between the missionaries, Catholic missionaries, and the Japanese government, resulting in many, many martyrs, maybe 35,000 people killed ultimately. But in this case, and it's a true story, two young priests from Portugal, Jesuits, decide to sneak into Japan undercover to administer to the hidden Christians. They had to worship undercover. They had to pretend they were not Christian. It's really a story about these two priests who go there, one priest named Rodriguez, based on a real character, or several characters, and ultimately what happens to him and when his faith is put to the test. And really, it's a story about faith. And interesting in the way that, does faith still speak to us today? What is faith? If you doubt so much, do you have faith? And that faith is doubting. It goes back and forth like that. And so I think ultimately it may be a timeless and universal story. For me, it's been an amazing shoot because normally I shoot pictures in New York or California, where there's like an apartment, a hotel, a bar, a nightclub, buildings where you could sit down in chairs and things. These are in mountains. And we had, you know, 2-3 feet of mud in the Tomoki village for the villagers. It rained and rained and heavy mist. And I was not, it was hard to direct when you start to move and the rubber boots you're wearing remains in the mud. It's sort of like those nightmares you have where you run, you never reach the person, you know. So it's been really a wild time shooting. But it's a project I wanted to make for 25 years, I think. It was given to me by a man named Paul Moore, which is the Archbishop of the Episcopal Archbishop of New York back in 1988, the summer of 1988. who had just seen a screening of The Last Temptation of Christ, which is a film I made then, which was causing a lot of controversy. And he liked the film, and he liked the approach to the picture. And he said, take a look at this book when you have time, because this is something that even goes deeper.
I just had to be a part of this new wonder. We risked everything. We sold the theater and everything we had so we could build our own movie studio.
In Hugo, was it challenging to keep the scenes faithful to the book? And did you use the illustrations as a basis for your set design?
Well, one of the things in reading the book, or looking at the book, I should say, because it lays itself out in pictures, it's so cinematic, the book, that it sparked that thing in me that I always had when I was a kid, which was I wanted to make pictures move. I liked drawing pictures, and then I saw them move. I thought it was amazing. I was like 5 or 4 years old. They kept taking me to the movies because I had terrible asthma, and they didn't know what to do with me. I couldn't play. They said, don't run, don't laugh, because if you laugh too much, you start to get, you can't breathe. And so they kept taking me to movies, and I would see these images move. I thought it was fascinating. And I would go back home and draw little pictures, and I imagine they move, you know? And so that, when I saw the book, the Selznick book, that really tapped into the earliest memories I have of being obsessed with the moving image and telling stories. And this was a little boy stuck hiding behind the walls, because I used to be all the time always having to stay home and staying. I couldn't go out, you know, so I was always looking out the window. With that, your imagination starts to go too. Good, bad, or indifferent, it's there. And so making up stories, you see movies, you hear other stories, people tell stories in the street and that sort of thing, you get the family. And I was putting all this together somehow. And so when I saw those pictures in the book, that impulse hit me again. I would love to do this, you know. And that main character was a little boy also, who was stuck behind the walls looking through the clocks. There was a conflict in that the way he drew it was so well done that we didn't want to just copy what he did. So we translated that into shots that I designed along with the beautiful production design by Dante Ferretti and his wife Francesca Lo Schiavo, and of course Bob Richardson's camera work, and add to that 3D. But a 3D that was really narratively expressive, not just things popping out of the camera. Because I always feel that 3D is important. I always like 3D because I think you can use the element of depth as a way to tell a story, as part of the element of narrative, because that's what we see, most people. You know, the bad rap with 3D has become, it's a gimmick, and you still have to wear the glasses. But there are certain films that were made in 3D that are not gimmicks, like Dial M for Murder, the Hitchcock, and a number of others. And that's what we tried in Hugo. We try to break new ground with the 3D. So visualizing it based on those drawings, we then pushed it. And let's say, okay, how can we get depth in this? And what would happen if the camera moves here? And they say, oh, you can't do that because your eyes will cross. And I said, oh, let's see. Well, let's try. And they said, no, you're gonna. I said, well, how do I know it's gonna be bad? They said, you'll feel it. And sure enough.
What is your favorite kind of film to direct and why?
I like music in films. Yeah, I like moving the camera to music. That's why I did some music documentaries. The Band and Bob Dylan and Neil Young and Joni Mitchell, all these people in The Last Waltz in 1976. I like the movement of the performer and then the movement of the camera with that, the editing music. Editing is like making music in a way. It's rhythmic. Two bars of music. I even do that in these fight scenes in this movie, Raging Bull, where I directed the fight scenes as if there were musical performances. So we did like 2 or 3, 5 or 6 punches were basically 2 bars of music and move that way and come around this way and that sort of thing. We didn't just put 7 cameras in the ring and shoot everything and then do it later in the cutting. It was all very specific. It took a lot of time and we went over budget. But, you know, and Erwin Winkler yelling, we're going over budget. I know. We almost finished. No, but I do like that. And also, I just did a documentary, a concert film, The Rolling Stones, Shine a Light. And we found that there, I couldn't really decide on camera. I tried to do camera moves, but the Rolling Stones group itself, Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, they move so fast. And I don't know where anybody's going to be. So I had Bob Richardson shooting it. We started out with 12 cameras and he wound up with 17. There was hardly any room for the performers because we didn't know where they were panning, out of focus. But they got some great stuff, I thought. And then as far as stories are concerned, I guess I'm more attuned to going back to the past that I experienced. It has to do with stories that have to do with people who feel very strongly about each other and whether or not a conflict arises where one has to betray the other. And for some reason over the years, those are the betray, support. How much do we take care of the other person? Are we our brothers, am I my brother's keeper from the Bible? That's what I think Cain said to God when he said, where's your brother? Remember when he killed Abel? Yeah. He said, what, am I my brother's keeper? He said, yes. And so maybe we are, you know? And so what does that entail? And can you always be true to that person, to that friend, to that loved one? And if you're not, can you redeem yourself another way? You see, those are the stories that I tend to find I'm drawn to.
When casting a role, is there anything you look for other than an actor who can nail the role?
I have to believe them. And that is something that is not that flip to say, really, because you really do. They have to convince you that they are that person. It's very much left to chance at times. But when we do have the casting sessions, usually I work with Alan Lowe since doing, like Goodfellas. And Goodfellas in 1989, when we went to cast it, Nick Pileggi, who's the writer, took us up to, of the book, took us up to Rayo's restaurant. And we were sitting there, and it's a place where it's all New York celebrities and wise guys, and guys are just in and out of jail, all kinds of, you know, very, very colorful place in a way, with great food. And I was sitting there, and I was with Ellen and Nick, and I said, that guy, who's this fellow? Well, he came over, said hello. I said, he's good for so-and-so. And we would cast the movie out of the restaurant. Not Ray Liotta, and not Bob De Niro, not Joe Pesci, but all the other characters who pretty much came in and said, hey, hello, how are you? This is so-and-so. Bo Dietl was there, everybody. It's almost like casting for me becomes, particularly if it's a film in the present day, a modern world, you know. A situation where people can get along with each other. Actors can get along with each other, where you could turn the camera on and they don't even know you have it on and they're still in character. And they're just talking and behaving the right way. They really have to know it. You can't teach. I couldn't teach an actor, I couldn't guide an actor to move the way Ray Liotta moved, let's say, or De Niro in those pictures, or Joe Pesci, or Lorraine Bracco in that particular film. It's different from, let's say, Cate Blanchett in The Aviator, whom when you see her walk into a room, she has total command of many different characters, many different roles, and she was able to take the essence of the great actress Katharine Hepburn. Now, how do you take that essence? I don't know. Actors still amaze me. I don't know how they do it.
Could you walk us through the film process? Do you rehearse with the actors before shooting? Do you repeat the scenes until you get them the way you envisioned?
The rehearsal is important. It's also it was nerve-wracking time. You know, so maybe the best way sometimes is just to sit in the room and talk. Don't even look at the script. Just talk and talk and argue and talk and laugh and, you know. And then maybe the next session is to start just read it. There's a scene in Goodfellas that Joe Pesci insisted I put in. And I said, he said, but I have to act it out for you. We're in a restaurant. I said, well, do it. He goes, no, I have to go. So we had to go to my apartment. I had to wait. So no. So, okay, now what's the scene? And he did this scene where that happened to him, where he was with some guy who was a kind of a street tough guy who was known to be kind of dangerous. And he was making jokes and he was laughing. And Joe Pesci said to him, boy, you're really funny. And the guy turned to us, what do you mean I'm funny?
I'm funny how? I mean funny like I'm a clown, I amuse you, I make you laugh.
And it became, he said, I could have been killed. And yet I did this and he did that. And I said, that's amazing, that's great. Because that's, it's really that, and that one scene encapsulates the lifestyle of what these people, how they're living. And so what we did was with Ray and Joe, we went to Carnegie Hall, they have on 57th Street, they have rehearsal halls. And we just reread the scenes and came up with lines based on the script. And then I played those, I had those tapes transcribed. So take one, take two, take three. And then I recombined the script from those takes and then gave it back to the actors. And I remember Joe, who, by the way, won the Academy Award for the role. This is a role, this is a scene that is so famous that he came up with, really happened to him. But when we were shooting it, he decided to improvise it completely. I said, no. We went through the whole thing. We did rehearsal. We went through all these stages. Now, if you hit this line, you hit this, it escalates, see? Well, I thought we could just, no. So it's always about shaping and feeling from the rehearsals, if they're in touch with the honesty of the situation, the truth of who they are as characters and what they're doing.
What is involved with the editing process?
Well, editing is something that I think I kind of imagine a movie and edit it. You'll see a Howard Hawks picture like Red River. I showed you guys in the editing is seamless. You can't see it, but you can see it in Hitchcock. How a camera move and a cut, face turns and everything else. The use of the cut creates another idea in your head or another impression, you know, that if you saw the shot by itself, wouldn't mean that much. But if you put the two together in the cut, something happens in your mind, and it's almost like shorthand. You're pulling out words, you know, and phrases, and suddenly this. And also, editing for me is like music and like dance, choreography. I usually think in editing terms. I usually, for example, I always have my notes on the set, the little drawings and stuff. The thing is, like, I'll always look at, if I'm shooting a scene, like I was late last night, I'm always looking at the scene before and the scene after. What's the last shot that I was going to do? All right, that last shot now, when I was in the hotel room thinking of this, I thought, okay, we go from this image to this image, you know, and then from that image, we go out to another image. So it's all structured that way. Thing is, something happens on the set, something happens on location. For example, in this movie, we're up in the mountains, there's a lot of mist. And suddenly I say, okay, action, and suddenly somebody comes through the mist. Well, that's a better opening than what I had planned in the hotel room, not on a mountain, you know? And so I've always started with the editing process, but the editing process is always in my head in a room by myself, like when I was a kid, making up stories. And then I take those and try to apply them to the picture. And also sometimes editing is about how much emphasis you give to one character as opposed to another in the editing of the film, the final editing, where, you know, we'll look at something, we'll cut it, we're middle of the night, we're tired. When we screen the film for friends or non-friends or whatever, you know, we look at it and say, I don't know, the people are feeling that they're not interested in this character that much anymore in this part of the movie. What was it? It's the weirdest thing. You can change a scene and something happens, but maybe nothing. And why? It's the scene before it. That you have to change the scene before, and that changes the scene that had the problems. And you haven't even touched that scene. And then people tell you, oh, you re-edited that scene. I said, no, we just... But it's not a science. It's all about the feeling and the emotional and psychological connection you have to the material you're doing. You really have to care about the people in the movie, and you got to care about the story you're telling. But it's like some giant puzzle in a way. You're never quite sure, why isn't that working now? Well, okay, what about this? Oh, now nobody's interested in her. Nobody's interested in her. Ah, yeah. He looks out to Goto this way.
It'll be over, end up being over there by that time.
Could he go this way?
Yeah, that's what we were doing with Benoit. The thing is that...
But he looks like... this is in the way, yeah.
Exactly.
But it should probably be pretty tight, this one.
Okay.
Just looking at... Should we... I mean, the fog is in the way, but should we do a plate or something tighter, free of, mm-hmm. clear of him?
What made you choose to be a director?
By the late 50s and early 60s, you know, by that time, you know, there was no way you say you could become a filmmaker or film director. You'd have to sort of be in the family. Films were made only in California. It was very rare to make films in the East Coast. The equipment was too big. But by the late 50s, things started changing. Cameras got smaller. And independent films were being made in New York. John Cassavetes and Shirley Clark and a number of others, meaning that they took a camera and they went out in the street. It looks, in some cases, it looked a little like a documentary, but not really. Then there was this incredible advanced camera called the Eclair from France, where you could carry it around and just walk around. And it was almost like the cameras today, but it just liberated all of us. So we didn't have, there was no intimidation saying, you can't do that. You need 20 trucks and 100 people. And so that added to the desire to tell these stories that I was experiencing in my own life. And they were stories that people, my father used to talk about films and something, it tells a story that happened to him in the 1930s and 1940s, and said, well, you can't put that on film. And I said, why not? Yeah. Why can't we explore it? Because other people were. There was that spark of telling the story that 40 years later, you still have to keep alive, despite going over schedule, over budget, the mud, not having, you know, an actor. Oh, last night an actor was coming in from Tokyo, but he got, something happened. He got into a fight at the airport and now he's in jail. So now we have to recast. It was only a few lines, but that's it. That happened one in the morning. So now we got to recast that person. Things like that at the last minute. Yeah. I don't know what happened, but in any event, somebody gets sick, unfortunately, somebody gets hurt, you really, what I'm saying is, of course, there are so many obstacles. You always have to go back to that reason. You have to keep that feeling pure of, and don't let it get in the way of what initially wanted you to make that film, you know, or go through this experience.
What advice would you give to a young person starting out in the film industry today?
When in the early 60s, I wanted to get a job in the film industry, I really couldn't. So we just worked on anything we could. I met Thelma at that time. We worked on documentaries. I tried to get on a movie as a production assistant, a major director, Elie Kazan, actually. So no, we don't do that. There wasn't that tradition. Now you could have interns, you could have production assistants, and they're exposed to the production on a daily basis, which is really very, 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 if anything, if you're interested in just the mechanics of how a picture is put together, or a film, or television, or internet pictures put together, because it's basically the same elements, do anything, deliver coffee, clean the floor, etc., bring water, or the people are dying of the thirst and the heat, you know, just, and if you're really wise, and if you're really interested, you keep your ears and eyes open, and then you find the people whom you can ask questions from, without disturbing them, without getting in the way. I would have been terrible. I would have been fired the first day, because I've been asking everybody everything. Now there really is no excuse. I mean, if you really have something you want to say, or you want to try, the camera's there. When I was growing up, we couldn't even afford an 8mm camera. I borrowed my friend's. I didn't know how to use it, but I tried. But what I mean is that you almost have too much technology at your disposal. There's always a way to find it. There's always a way to do it. Even the home video camera you can do it with, or the computer you can do it with. So it always reverts back to, if you feel that you have something you want to say and something you want to contribute, and then you just shape that to the medium. And the medium now is infinite. It's not just celluloid in a camera that you need a lot of lights for. So at this point, it's a whole new aesthetic and a whole new cinema, quote unquote. It's a new medium. I have no idea where it's going to go. It's very exciting because it's up to you, and you have to reinvent it.
Cool. Okay.
Cool?
Cool. Yeah. One more question. No. That was the
what?
Last one.
Okay.
Yeah, who's your favorite daughter?
Jasmine?
I'll show you our room. It's a mess.
Can you get in the room? Seriously.
You ate for breakfast?
We had some really good eggs, and they had smoked salmon and caviar.
With caviar.
And then we had ice cream. That's a wrap.